Testimony continuing today in the George Zimmerman murder trial. He, of course, accused of murdering Trayvon Martin, a killing that he claims was in self-defense. Today, the six jurors heard from people in the neighborhood that night, the only witnesses to the incident. At issue, who was the aggressor the night Trayvon Martin was killed?
Jonathan Good, a neighbor with one of the best vantage points of the struggle that rainy February night last year, believed he saw Trayvon Martin on top of George Zimmerman, beating him MMA style.
And he was the one who was raining blows down on the person on the bottom, George Zimmerman, right?
That's what it looked like.
But he revised his testimony to say he just saw downward arm movements. Good also said he couldn't support Zimmerman's story that his life was at risk from Martin using concrete like a weapon.
Did you ever see the person on top pick the person from the bottom and actually slam them into the concrete?
No.
Did you ever see the person on top slamming the person on the bottom's head on the concrete over and over and over?
No.
Did you see at any time the person on top grab the person on the bottom's head and slam it into the concrete?
No.
Good went inside to call 911 when he heard the gunshot. His testimony is in conflict with that of a different neighbor who testified yesterday that she believes she saw Zimmerman on top. Also on the stand, a third neighbor who took these photos of Zimmerman's bloody head and Martin's body. Zimmerman asked him to call his wife.
I said, your husband has been involved in a shooting. He's being handcuffed and he's going to be held for questioning at the Sanford Police Department. And around that time, he kind of cut me off and he says, just tell her I shot someone.
All right, so the trial obviously is going to continue next week. Mayo, I'm curious, how critical to Zimmerman's defense is the issue of who appeared to have been the aggressor that night?
Well, I think it's important, but it's not necessarily dispositive because the tapes, the 911 tapes, give a different story, and they show that Zimmerman was pursuing Trayvon Martin and that the police asked him to stop. In fact, told him, you don't need to do that. We're on our way. So at that point, he's a catalyst to set this entire incident in motion. Now, it is important.
Does that offset what the witnesses may have said if they saw, let's say, Trayvon on top of Zimmerman?
Well, I think it very well may, because what happens is if Mr. Zimmerman is pursuing Trayvon Martin and is the aggressor at that point, Trayvon Martin would then be able to, quote-unquote, stand his ground and defend himself. And in New York State, that would be Article 35 of the penal law. So you have the ability to protect yourself. Now, even if he was able to let's say, get on top of Mr. Zimmerman, he wouldn't be committing a crime at that point, as long as he doesn't go beyond the force necessary to protect himself. He's roughly half Zimmerman's size. He's a teenager. Zimmerman's a grown man who knows he has a gun. So that testimony is important. But also, when you look at the witness contradicting earlier testimony,
right,
that's significant. So it seems as if earlier it had been suggested that Mr. Zimmerman's head was being smashed into the ground. But upon his examination at trial today, he gives a different story and says he never actually saw any of that.
When you have witnesses contradicting one another, is that enough to be probable cause? That's certainly one of the things that we always hear, that, you know, just the slightest shred of doubt and that's good for Zimmerman.
What a judge generally will instruct the jury is that it's up to you to try or effect to determine what weight, if any, you're going to give to the testimony. So they have to assess the credibility of the people who are testifying, and they have to use the same things that we use every day to determine whether someone's telling us the truth. What was the person's ability to see? Did they change their story from a story that they had earlier conveyed? What's their ability to remember? What were the lighting conditions? All of those things come into play. So that's what these jurors are going to have to determine.
And the injuries that Zimmerman suffered, that was one of the things I was curious about, because he claimed that, you know, his life was in danger. Is that a fair takeaway from finding out what the extent of Zimmerman's injuries were? The worse they were, the more danger he was in?
Not necessarily, but what I would say that looking at Mr. Zimmerman's injuries, they seem to be head injuries. They seem to be relatively minor from the photos I can see, and you tend to bleed much more from your head. There are a lot of capillaries, lots of blood vessels there, so you can yield a lot of blood from a very superficial wound. And you don't see hematomas, you don't see contusions, significant bruising on Mr. Zimmerman's head. It seems to be otherwise fine other than a few scratches in the back, and the blood that you see doesn't seem to be, he doesn't seem to have been bleeding profusely.
With all of the news that we've had this week, in a very busy week, we haven't had a chance to cover this trial in a couple of days. Much of those days, or many of those days, were dominated by the testimony of Trayvon Martin's friend Rachel Gentel, the last person he spoke with as Trayvon and Zimmerman crossed paths. First part of her testimony, as we talked about here, we thought it sort of helped prosecutors, but she went through a very tough cross-examination.
That's why you didn't do anything. It was because Trayvon Martin started the fight, and you knew that.
Objection, compound question, badgering the witness.
Are you claiming in any way that you don't understand English?
I understand you.
You said that it could have been, for all you know, Trayvon Martin smashing George Zimmerman in the face, is what you actually heard.
What?
Yeah, just earlier today.
By who?
By you.
You ain't getting that from me.
And then we also got this exchange. Zimmerman's lawyer accused Gentel of lying about a letter she wrote to Trayvon's mother explaining what she saw that night. She was asked to read a portion which a friend helped her write.
Are you unable to read that at all?
Some of them I do not.
Can you read any of the words on it?
I don't understand. Cursive. I don't read curses.
Couple of questions that come out of this, obviously. The first is, do you think from those clips and from what you've seen this week that the cross-examination in any way deflated her testimony, which a lot of people had seen as being pretty damning against Zimmerman?
Not really. I mean, what I saw was a young girl on the stand, and, you know, this is not her career. She's not there every day. So most witnesses get nervous. It's a difficult place to be for any trial, but this is a trial that's receiving international attention. What I didn't hear were answers to those questions. So I heard a lot of questions, but there was no real response to the question. And the other thing that's important to remember is she's not really an eyewitness. She's an ear witness. Mm. She was on the phone. And to be honest, I mean, how would you know who was landing the blow by the phone? That's why you really do need the two eyewitnesses. And the jury's going to have to assess their credibility to determine what happened there.
The thing that struck me the most out of this was something that hasn't gotten a lot of coverage yet. But she was there for 7 hours total on the stand, 2 days in a row. And the second day, she gave a bunch of yes, sir. She gave a yes, Mr. West, I think is his name, right? And she had a total flip on attitude. And the lawyer said to her, and across early in the morning, said, did somebody talk to you last night? Do you have a change of attitude? And her response was, she got a good night's sleep. Now, me as an observer, that strikes me as an outright lie. And it would make me question what coaching was taking place and what she was hiding from in that regard. Now, it's a minor thing, but it would make me wonder what that would be.
But tell me a single witness that hasn't been coached.
No,
every witness is coached by counsel.
And I totally agree with you.
Are witnesses allowed to be coached?
But
of course they're allowed to be coached.
But my point is, no, but my point is that it seemed to be a lie that she told. It was a very, like you say, because she was afraid of what that truthful answer would do to her, she was fearful.
I want to jump, because anybody else put off by how seemed to have been treated on the stand?
Well, that's a great question. I thought that the defense attorney, I mean, you're the lawyer here, I thought he did an excellent job. What is the job of a defense lawyer on cross-examination? It is to get under your skin, to make you flip your statements, to have you spinning so much you don't know if you're coming or going. And I'm supposed, am I right or wrong?
Well,
you're supposed to do it with a smile.
You have to be very careful, in particular when you're dealing with someone who is a vulnerable or sympathetic witness. And here you have a young girl. She's nervous. Clearly, absolutely, she gives a different response to the prosecution than she does to the defense. And absolutely, she's spoken to people before she got on the stand. And it's simpler and easier simply to say yes. You know, and I doubt if anyone told her to get up there and lie. Nonetheless, at the end of the day, you don't want to come across as having pressured this kid and really put her in a position where she becomes more sympathetic than she otherwise would be. You can accomplish everything that he tried to accomplish without going that extra step. You can simply ask the question, do you understand what's written here? It's pretty clear that she's struggling with that answer. You don't have to go beyond that. The jury can look at her and tell that the answer is she really probably didn't write that statement or had assistance in writing the statement. Maybe she gave the verbal account and someone else reduced it to writing.
If the takeaway, and I've seen some of this online, if the takeaway is, well, she may be illiterate or she has trouble reading, does that weaken her as a witness?
Not at all, because it's not an SAT here. What you're talking about is what you heard, and that's basically it.
And the question rather is, how are the sick? It doesn't matter whether we are offended. Defense counsel was trying to show that she can't read. Yeah, the question is, How are the six women on that jury going to react?
The thing that struck me was,
I got to jump. I'm sorry. I'm so heavy. We're going to take a quick break here on RFL. Stay with us.